Thank you for auditing Professor Skye's record review, the only first listen always positive new music review show hosted by a French professor immediately after leaving the gym. So I'm going to be asking a question that's intentionally provocative. I'm going to be reviewing the album Slow Rush by Tame Impala, and I plan on actually trying to share this video with the Tame Impala Reddit with this provocative question. Does anybody love Tame Impala? And why? How do people love this band? That's always been my question. I understand why people respect them. I understand why people like them. I even understand why people enjoy listening to them. But ever since their debut in 2010, at least that's when I first heard it, I think that's when it came out, maybe 2011, ever since then, I've just never quite gotten it. There's just not enough to hold on to, you know? Like, the vocals, they seem to kind of go between, like, high and super high. Like, sometimes they get kind of John Lennon, steel and metallic, and I like that. And the musicianship is good, and certainly they're highly influential. The majority of rock music that I review or listen to very, very clearly bears the mark of their psychedelic renaissance, whatever it was that they did that allowed rock to be somewhere in between, like, far out and trippy and hard rocking and you know, brought a little bit of respect back to guitar and bass and drums. Now, the thing is, I ask this question, how and why do you love Tame Impala? And I want people to answer the question. I want to read it in the comments. I want them to say, hey, Skye, you're a jerk. I love them and I've always loved them and you don't understand. But the thing is, this show is always positive, okay? I would never review something I dislike. I would never review something just to poop on it, okay? That's a waste of time. It's like shooting kittens in a barrel. There's just no point in giving bad reviews. Don't watch them. That's my advice. So how do I come to this album, Slow Rush? My search is to find out, is to figure out what is it that people love about this band. Certainly it can't just be NPR and the Manchester Guardian who love Tame Impala. It can't just be that they are the number one pitchfork band in the universe, right? Somebody loves this band, right? Somebody listens to this and goes, oh yeah! So let's get into it, okay? First of all, the cover. Beautiful cover. This like weird red house with like sand coming in, and that emphasizes a lot of the themes of the album about like time passing and sort of abandoned dreams and wastelands. And the name of the band is great, Tame Impala. It's like sort of like, what? I mentioned it to my wife the other day and she's like, I've never heard of Tim and Paula. I said, no, Tame Impala. She said, oh, I've heard of them. And even the name of the album is great, Slow Rush, you know? Like, everything about this is just super solid. And the production is super solid. Maybe that's what people love. I'm not sure they can love his voice. I don't know. Maybe they do. I don't. I think it's fine. It's serviceable. But boy, the production is excellent on this record. Apparently, it's this one guy, I forget his name, Mr. Tame Impala, and he just does everything. So, you know, I used to do that when I had a four-track back in last century. So, you know, that's very impressive to have one person make music that is this rich and this detailed. Maybe that's what they love. Maybe they do love the lyrics. Maybe they do love the singing, the way that it layers in, because the album is very well layered. That production that I'm talking about, it's sometimes each, like, some songs feel like two in one, you know, like, the song Posthumous Forgiveness, there's like this break and then a whole nother part comes in. It has that sort of very 2020 modular feel with different parts coming in. Maybe it's just the atmosphere. They're so good at creating this hazy atmosphere. And again, that's why I asked the question, because to me, I love things with really strong melodies or that are very aggressive and unsettling or easy to listen to, but it's just a sort of atmosphere. And actually for much of it, it even reminds me of sort of like almost like vaporwave music, you know? Like it feels like it's very consciously 80s, very consciously keyboard, very consciously dreamy in that way. Not so much in the psychedelic, like let's take mushrooms and look at our hands kind of thing, but a lot more like, let's like watch YouTube videos of malls in slow motion. I get that feel of more. Now, if I kind of like go track by track, I've already touched on some of the things about this album. It starts off with this cool kind of burpy vocoder sound, and that was interesting to me because that isn't what I associated with them. And then the kind of whiny singing comes in, but then by the end of the song, it's kind of upbeat and danceable. And that's the thing about this album. I guess I've only listened to their first album. What was that album called? It's the one with spirals and kaleidoscopes. I forget what it is. That's the only one I've ever really listened to. But I didn't really associate them with danceable. This whole album, you put it on and you can dance to it very easily. The next track, Instant Destiny. I intentionally actually listened to this album 3 times before reviewing it. When I asked this question, why does anybody love this band? I needed to take it very seriously that it was possible to love this band. And on the 3rd listen, I really started to get it. And I think it's the drums. Now, maybe that's not always the case with this band. But on this album, the drumming is the best drumming I've heard since the Hippocampus album. This is excellent drumming. I can't believe that the songwriter is also the drummer. Just for this alone, I am starting to love Tame Impala. Because the drum beats on here, they're almost like the best hip-hop style drum beats. Like you just kind of get into this groove. And so it's not just danceable with like a drum machine, it's like danceable with an actual groove. It's quite strong. Similar, the track Borderline and that Posthumous Forgiveness all go in that kind of disco area. It actually reminds me a lot of Justice's last album. You know, Justice is the French duo that's sort of EDM and sort of following in Daft Punk's footsteps. And this feels very much in that vein of sort of like good artists who decided that disco is good. Good disco is good. Why not listen to good disco? Then there's this track, Breathe Deeper, which feels almost just like straight up like pop, you know? Just like saying, I can, even kind of sounds at some points like Isley Brothers. There's sort of like a 70s soul, 80s soft rock vibe that goes throughout the entire album. And I think that's what's happened to psychedelic music. I think that you just can't get more psychedelic and weird than 80s soft rock, it turns out. Who knew? What's nice is the second part I mentioned before has this like cool kind of arpeggiator, and it's clear that he's like mixing ideas sort of together at once. And he's doing a good job with it. Tomorrow's Dust has this great bit with these drums. And in general, the drums are not just well played. It's like he like pans them differently around your ears while you have your headphones on. And they have that great, very muted 70s feel to them. Like a really cool drum set, cool feeling, great sounds. By far, my favorite track on the album as a whole is a track called I said track twice leading up to this song title, knowing that the word track was in the title. This is why I should write scripts. It would go like this. My favorite song on this record is definitely On Track. It is an excellent track. You see? Even if I wrote it out, it wouldn't work. Just beautiful production. This is the best usage of his drum style, where he's actually playing the drums behind the singing. And when I heard this song the 3rd time, I loved it. Okay? Okay, Tame Impala fans, you have a name for yourselves? Are you the Chevys? Is that what you call yourselves? I don't know what you call yourselves. But this track is just great, with the drums playing catch up, and it's actually catchy. For the most part, most of the words, I feel that when he sings them, they get lost. Because it's like, it's all part of the fabric, right? The thing about a lot of like psychedelic music or music that's trying to be a little more experimental, they often lose track of like words and what words mean. But this whole song is all about like, strictly speaking, I'm still on track. It's a great lyric. I went shopping in between the gym and coming back home, and like I was with my wife, and like she told me to go get something, but I got something else. But I was on my way to get the thing she was asking for. I was supposed to get milk, and I ended up just getting a lot of Swiss cheese. And I thought to myself, well, strictly speaking, I'm still on track to get the milk. Like, that's how quickly this song like burrowed its way into my head. And that's the question I have again for you, my Chevy Impala fans. Is that what it is? Is it just that like multiple listenings, it just gets just woven into your mind? Is this awesome, amazing, great music? It's so hard to tell. I guess I'll have to give it more time. Lost in Yesterday isn't really a song. It's kind of a ditty, but they have cool phaser sounds. I don't mean phaser like, I mean like, pew, 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 like pew, pew, you know? Pew pew sounds. That was supposed to be Han Solo, not naked Obi-Wan Kenobi. But you get my point. Like, pew pew, laser sounds, you know? And that's kind of cool. And that leads into Is It True, which is another really great dance song. I sort of want to have a dance party to this album. And this has this cool sort of like attacking keyboard solo, like a melody lead with a really strong keyboard sound. And in general, there's very little guitar. I thought this was a guitar band. Is it just this album? Because I hardly hear any guitar. When I hear guitar, it's on a track like Glimmer, which is two ahead here, which is basically just a house song. And then the guitar is like a Nile Rodgers style disco guitar. And I'm not going to talk about, I'll talk about the last song, One More Hour, which is nice because it has kind of an epic feeling. And the first track is called like One More Year, and this is One More Hour. And everything all ties together with this theme of, I think, this guy feeling like he's a beautiful room that's getting filled with sand. It's, the whole thing seems like a midlife crisis being described, in which case, congratulations, Tame Impala, you've written an interesting album. Thank you for singing about something important, not just talking about colors and paisley and whatever, but actually singing about what's happening in your life. In that way, I can imagine getting into it. When I do key into the lyrics, which is rarely because of the way that he sings, which I think is usually forgettable, still, when I do pick up what he says is meaningful and I like. This is particularly true for the song that I thought was the worst song on the album, It Might Be Time. This is the great ode of middle age, where he's talking about not being cool anymore and not being important anymore and watching all of his friends getting married. Thank you. There needs to be more songs about being in your mid-30s. You know, there just need to be, because you're only like in your 20s for like 5 years, you know? I think my math checks out. So this is a song that I thought was terrible. I thought it was kind of the most boring, almost had like a kind of the 80s keyboards going on. But then the drums come in, and this song is so stuck in my head, just this drum part, because not only do the drums go, but they have like a Kill Bill keyboard. You remember in Kill Bill when they do the zoom? You know, Tarantino is ripping off some kung fu movie, I think. But he uses that sound, and it's just, you just get so pumped up. So I'm actually going to play that a little bit for you now, because I think it is worth a listen. I probably should have brought this up on my computer already, which I didn't. But that's okay, because I'm pretty quick with my computer. So yeah, this is the song that really saved the album for me, and I absolutely loved it. Like, I just loved this song. I loved the end, despite finding the beginning of it to be kind of laborious and boring. So I'm going to play you just a little bit of the end here. Just awesome, you know, and the kind of like Steely Dan keyboards going in the back. This is awesome. I love it. So I don't know. I don't love Tame Impala still. I love these two songs. I love On Track. I love the end of It Might Be Time. I still don't find enough to hold on to. But I am sincerely asking, what is it that you love about Tame Impala if you love them? Or are they just one of these bands that works on paper, that works for music critics, that evolves in the right way, but fundamentally just doesn't have that thing? They're certainly one of the greatest, most important, influential rock and roll bands of this century. But do you love them? Okay. Until next time, I'm gonna go eat some eggs. There's the camera.